राधे गोविंद माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स, होप यू आर लर्निंग फ्रॉम माय वीडियोस एंड द मटेरियल प्रोवाइडेड टू यू। टुडे वी विल डिस्कस द यूडीपी एंड टीसीपी प्रोटोकॉल्स। ओके, सो यूडीपी इज वन ऑफ द टू मेन प्रोटोकॉल्स टू रिसाइड ऑन टॉप ऑफ द इंटरनेट प्रोटोकॉल आईपी। इट ऑफर्स सर्विस टू यूजर्स नेटवर्क एप्लीकेशन। एग्जाम्पल नेटवर्क एप्लीकेशन दैट यूज यूडीपी आर नेटवर्क फाइल सिस्टम एंड सिंपल नेटवर्क मैनेजमेंट प्रोटोकॉल। द सर्विस इज लिटिल मोर देन एन इंटरफेस टू आईपी। द यूडीपी इज ए कनेक्शन लेस डेटाग्राम डिलीवरी सर्विस। बट द टीसीपी इज कनेक्शन ओरिएंटेड सर्विस। ओके, सो द यूडीपी डज नॉट गारंटी डिलीवरी। यूडीपी डज नॉट मेंटेन end to end connection with the remote UDP module. Remember this thing, that UDP does not maintain an end to end connection with the remote UDP module. It merely pushes the datagram out on the net and accepts incoming datagram of the net. UDP adds two values to what is provided by IP. One is the multiplexing of information between application based on the port number. The other is checksum to check the integrity of the data. So we will focus on these two services. So how does a client on one computer reach the server on another? Okay, so the path of communication between an application and UDP is through UDP ports. Okay, these ports are numbered beginning with zero. An application that is offering service, which means the server waits for a message to come in on a specific port dedicated to that service. The server waits patiently for any client to request service. For instance, the SNMP server called an SNMP agent always waits on port number 161. Okay, so there can be only one SNMP agent per computer because there is only one UDP port number 161. Okay, so remember this thing, there can be only one SNMP agent per computer because there is only one UDP port number 161. This port number is well known. It is a fixed number, an internet assigned number. If an SNMP client wants service, it sends its request to port number 161 of UDP on the destination computer. So here you can understand how UDP can be used for taking the services from servers. When an application sends data out through UDP, it arrives at the far end as a single unit. For example, if an application does 5 writes to the UDP port, the application at the far end will do 5 reads from the UDP port. Also, the size of each write matches the size of each read. So UDP preserves the message boundary defined by the application. It never joins two application messages together or divides a single application message into parts. So this is the basic phenomena of UDP. So whenever you want to send unbreakable messages with the boundaries, then you will use UDP. Okay, so now the second main important part of UDP is the checksum. An incoming IP packet with an IP header type field indicate UDP is passed to the UDP module by IP. So when the UDP module receives the UDP datagram from IP, it examines the UDP checksum. If the checksum is zero, it means that the checksum was not calculated by the sender and can be ignored. Thus, the sending computer's UDP module may or may not guarantee checksums. If Ethernet is the only network between the two UDP modules communicating, then you may need checksumming. Okay. So, however, it is recommended that checksum generation always be enabled, because at some point in the future, a root table change may send the data across less reliable media. So, if the checksum is valid or zero, the destination port number is examined, and if application is bound to that port, an application message is queued for the application to read. So every message is queued before reading if there are some another messages. Otherwise the UDP datagram is discarded. If the incoming UDP datagram arrives faster than the application can read them, and if the queue fills to a maximum value, UDP datagram are discarded by UDP. UDP will continue to discard UDP datagram until there is a space in the queue. So always remember that it controls flow by using these queues. Now the next is transmission control protocol, which is the main protocol, another main protocol of transport layer. It provides different kind of services than UDP. TCP offers a connection oriented byte stream instead of a connection less datagram delivery services. So here you can understand that the message can be partition into bytes, and the connection is established instead of using ports at which the server always listens for any request. Okay, so TCP is used, so TCP guarantees delivery, whereas UDP does not. It is a very important point, should be noted down. It generally asks in the competitive examinations that which guarantees delivery, TCP or UDP. So you always remember that TCP guarantees delivery, but UDP does not guarantee delivery. TCP is used by network application that require guaranteed delivery and cannot be bothered with doing time outs and retransmissions. Okay, so TCP cannot be bothered with doing timeouts and retransmissions. The two most typical network application that use TCP are file transfer protocol, when you transfer files from one phone to another phone by share it or Xander kind of applications, and the Telnet. Other popular TCP network application include X Windows System, RCP, remote copy, and the R series command. TCP's greater capability is not without cost. It requires more CPU and network bandwidth. The internals of the TCP module are much more complicated than those in a UDP module. Similar to UDP, network applications connect to TCP ports. Okay, so there exists TCP port also. These are well-defined port numbers which are dedicated to specific applications. For instance, the Telnet server uses port number 23. These all port numbers are listed in the material provided by me, but you must remember these one or two port numbers. That Telnet server uses port number 23. The Telnet client can find the server simply by connecting to port 23 of TCP on the specified computer. When the application first starts using TCP, the TCP module on the client's computer and the TCP module on the server's computer start communicating with each other using the port number. These two endpoint TCP modules contain state information that defines a virtual circuit. So they establish a virtual circuit between the end-to-end devices. This virtual circuit consumes resources in both TCP endpoints. The virtual circuit is full duplex channel, you know, that means they can simultaneously send or receive the messages. Data can go in both directions simultaneously. The application writes data to TCP port. The data travels the network and is read by the application at further end by the at the TCP port by the another host. The TCP packetizes the byte stream at will. It does not retain the boundaries between wires. For example, if an application does 5 writes to TCP port, the application at the far end might do 10 reads to get all the data, or it might get all the data with a single read. So there is no correlation between the number and size of write at one end to the number and size of reads at the other end, unlike UDP. So TCP is a sliding window protocol with timeout and retransmits. So outgoing data must be acknowledged by the far end TCP. Acknowledgement can be piggybacked on data. Both receiving ends can flow control the far end, thus preventing a buffer overrun. So as with all sliding window protocol, the protocol has a window size. The window size determines the amount of data that can be transmitted before an acknowledgement is required. For TCP, this amount is not a number of TCP segment but a number of bytes. So this is the UDP and TCP protocol. Now, for the network applications, why do both TCP and UDP exist instead of just one or the other? That means we can use TCP, either TCP or UDP, to send or receive data. Then why do we need these two protocols? So think about these questions. In the next class, we will discuss about it and more about the some issues related to TCP and UDP. So stay home and stay safe at the home and keep learning. All the best and all the success for the examination. And please read out this RFC for your more understandability. Okay, all the best.